I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah, yeah, louder than my unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Oh, heaven comes to fight for me. Come on, sing. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder. Hear my praises roar. Come on, say, I raise a hallelujah.
Welcome to VWCC News Bulletin. Tony Evans, Crystal Evans Hutz presents Kingdom Women will be our feature book at Women Within Virtual on Zoom on October 10th, 2020 at 10 a.m. If you want to be a part of the Zoom meeting, contact us via email walkinvictory@sbcglobal.net and phone 248-385-2312. You will be glad and blessed to be there. God bless. Starting back next month, Isaiah 58 Outreach will be starting back up next month, every fourth Saturday in every month. We are accepting monetary donation, perishable items such as food, toiletry. You can cash up us your donation as required. Sow a seed to the poor, you will be blessed.
Lord, and welcome to this edition of Victoria's Word Christian Center's broadcast here on YouTube. As always, thank you so much. This is the day that the Lord hath made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. We're still moving in the apostolic flow, and this is part two, so I don't want you to miss a segment of this particular series. It's going to be informative, it's going to be powerful, and it's going to be life-changing. I don't want you to miss a segment. So we're going to pray, and then we're going to get into our base scripture, which is Ephesians, the second chapter and the 18th verse. We're going to go there after we pray, and then we'll get back into moving in the apostolic flow. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you now for your goodness, mercy, and grace. We thank you. This is the day that you have made, and we shall rejoice and be glad. And we thank you for the supernatural manifestation, revelation, and supernatural inspiration of the Spirit of God. Now, we apply and appropriate the blood of Jesus, the name of Jesus, and the power of the Holy Spirit to this message today, that the listeners, the hearers, and the viewers will be blessed thereby. Now, Father, we expect that signs, wonders, and miracles shall follow this preached word. We expect that bodies will be healed, lives will be changed, devils will be cast out, just as it was in the book of Acts. Now, God, we say thank you now, and we give you praise in advance for what you're going to do. In the name of Jesus, thank God. Amen. So glad to have you along today. As always, I want you to do something for me. I want you to do three things for me. I want you to subscribe to this broadcast. Subscribe. Hit the subscribe button so you'll get every lesson that we teach here at Victorious Word. Number two, I want you to like. Let us know that it's effective in your life. Subscribe, like it, and then I want you to share it with one of your loved ones, with your friend, your coworker, your neighbor, somebody that you believe will be beneficial and will be benefited by these messages that we preach here. Let's go to the book of Ephesians, the second chapter. Ephesians, the second chapter. Amen. Praise the Lord. Ephesians, the second chapter and the 18th verse. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Ephesians 2 and 18. For through him we both have access by one Spirit, both talking about the Jews and the Gentiles, by one Spirit unto the Father. Therefore, we are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. And we're built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, and Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. So that's where we want to be. We want to be right here in Ephesians, the second chapter and the 20th verse. And are built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ, the stone, the cornerstone, the stone that the builders rejected have become the chief cornerstone. The chief cornerstone is the stone in which everything else is built around. The cornerstone, Jesus being the chief cornerstone of the church of the living God. So we're talking about flowing in the apostolic government of God, the New Testament ministry of the apostles in the book of Acts, that in conjunction with the gifting and the office of the prophet, develop the kind of leadership template that God designed for his church to walk in. Now, the church in the book of Acts was first and foremost an apostolic church. Signs, wonders, miracles, following the preached word. Bodies were being healed. Demons were being cast out. Lives were being changed. People were being delivered. People were being saved. He was adding to the church daily such as should be saved. That is the true spirit of the apostolic ministry. And that's what we're talking about. As we said last week, we're not talking about a church name, a church denomination. We're talking about the spirit of the apostolic flow. where we expect, and God is a God who expects you and I to expect. We have service together. We have service virtually. When we pray, when we fast, when we lay hands, when we confess, we expect certain things to take place. We expect it. And we should, because our God is a mighty God who does signs, wonders, and miracles, who does exploits. And we should do exploits, because the Bible declares we should receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon us. We should receive power. Power what? Power to live right. Power to do right. Power for healing. Power for prosperity. Power for overcoming the wiles and the tricks of the devil. Power. Don't you desire power today? Don't you want power? Don't you need power? When our God rose, Jesus rose, the Bible declares he rose with all power in his hands. All power. So the apostolic assignment means much more than just simply evangelizing. It means much more than that. And we should evangelize. We should evangelize unbelievers. We should evangelize for the regeneration of backsliders. We should evangelize so people will know about the healing grace that's the healing grace that's contained in the Word of God. We should evangelize. But it's more than just evangelism and being an evangelist. It is the beginning of the task to evangelize. Here's why. Converts must be discipled. Discipled. Taught to be like Jesus. Let's look at Matthew 28 and 19. Matthew 28, 19 and 20. Matthew. Hallelujah. Don't you want to be more like Jesus? Don't you want to walk like Jesus and talk like Jesus? Don't you want to act like Jesus? Don't you want to represent Jesus in the earth realm? Don't you want to be a living epistle, a living example of the beauty of holiness? Don't you want to walk like Jesus walked? Don't you want to Don't you want to talk like Jesus talked? Don't you want to do the same exploits that Jesus did? Certainly we do. Because sinners and unbelievers and those who are not regenerated, you know what they're looking for? They're looking for evidence. Where is the evidence of your faith? Where's the evidence of what you believe? Where is the evidence of what you are confessing? Evidence. Somebody say evidence. We need evidence today, Pastor. We need evidence. Yes, we do. We need evidence. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to get there in a minute, but I got excited and I just kind of strayed off the beaten path here. But Matthew 28 and 19. Here's the mission of the apostolic spirited church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Here's what we should be doing. Matthew 28 and 19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, all races, creeds, colors, ethnicities. Teach all nations. People will not learn. They must be taught. They won't come. They must be brought. And they learn and are taught by example. They want to see what Jesus has done for us first. They want to hear the testimony of how he delivered us. They want to hear the testimony of how he set us free, how he took our feet out of the miry clay and set them on a rock to say, and that rock is Jesus. The stone that the builders rejected has now become the chief cornerstone. Go ye therefore into all nations, teaching all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, and teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even till the end of the world. What a promise Jesus made us in the flow of the apostolic anointing. He's like, I'm with you. I will never leave you or forsake you. Lo, I'm with you. I'm with you always, even to the end. You're never alone, even to the end of the world. You're never alone. Always got a companion with you. Got Jesus with you. Father's with you. The Son is with you. The Holy Ghost is with you. All these folks are with you. You're never alone. That's why we walk by faith and not by sight. We don't walk by feelings. A whole lot of times you may experience this feeling of loneliness that will overshadow you. But then you have to shake yourself and say, I'm not alone. Jesus made me a precious promise that he would never leave me. And when he left, he said, I will not leave you comfortless, but I will leave a comforter with you, called the Holy Spirit, who will lead and guide you into all truth. And that's who's here now. Ephesians 4 and 11. Hallelujah. Ephesians 4 and 11. When Jesus ascended into heaven, Jesus cared enough and loved us enough and was concerned so much about our spiritual and physical well-being until Jesus actually left some gifts. When he ascended into heaven, he left some gifts. Don't you like gifts? Everybody likes gifts. But you know what? The problem tends to be not everybody appreciates the gift. Sometimes we get a gift that's re-gifted. Get a gift somebody gives us that somebody gave to them. They didn't want it, so they pass it along to us. Sometimes we get a gift and we don't necessarily like it, so we just throw it in the closet, gathers dust. So not everybody appreciates the gifts. But he gave us some gifts. Your pastor is a gift to you. Your pastor is a gift to your ministry, the church that the Lord Jesus Christ made him under shepherd or made her under shepherd over. They're a gift to you. Jesus left us with some gifts. Ephesians 4 and 11 says, and he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Why did he give those gifts, Pastor? He gave those gifts for you and I. Gave those gifts for our development. And so we could eventually fulfill the purpose. Fulfill the purpose of God in our lives to benefit the kingdom. He gave us some light, precious gifts. Called apostles and prophets and evangelists and pastors and teachers. Why did he give the gifts, Pastor Walker? He gave the gifts for the perfecting of the saints. For the perfecting of the saints. For the maturing of the saints. To grow us up so we will be no more children being tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine that comes along, that we'll know how to stand flat-footed against the devil, the spiritual, so we can get out of our flesh and begin to walk in the spirit and leave sin alone and leave transgression alone and leave iniquity alone, so that we will become mature saints in the things of God and the things of the kingdom. Hey, so we can walk the apostolic flow and flow in the anointing of the apostolic spirit, the Holy Spirit, and not have this hit and miss gospel for the perfecting of the saints. For what, Pastor? For the work of the ministry. Ministry is work. And here's what ministry is. Ministry is people. You don't like people. You have no business ministering or pastoring anybody's church. Because ministry is people. You gotta love people. You have to love all types of people. All types of people. Good people, bad people, tall people, short people, black people, white people, fat people, thin people, good people, bad people. You have to love them all. Didn't say you love what they're doing. Didn't say you love their actions that are contrary to the word of God, to the spirit of God, to the commandments of God. I'm saying you have to love them. Here's what you have to love the hell out of them. To love them. The love of God be shed abroad in your heart for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of whose body? The body of Christ. Because when it's all said and done, it's all about Jesus. It's not about you and I. It's all about him. It's all about his glory. It's all about lifting up his name. It's all about magnifying him for who he is, his goodness, his mercy, his grace toward the children of men. It's all about, it's all about him. It's not about us. Because he's trying to take us somewhere. He's trying to take us, and here's where he's trying to take us in verse 13. Till we all, somebody say all, till we all, we shouldn't leave anybody behind. Until we all come into the unity of the faith. There's only one faith. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. We are striving to come into the unity of not some faith, not a faith, but the faith. And also the knowledge of the Son of God until we become a perfect man, a mature man, a grown man, able to eat spiritual meat and not be stuck on pablum, similac, and things that are not like God. Hallelujah. That's what we need to do. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah to the Lamb. This thing is going to stay on this podium tonight. There ain't nothing but the devil. But I rebuke him in Jesus' name. Amen. So, till we come into the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. So we want to obtain and attain the fullness of what Jesus Christ has for us in our lives. That's the destination for us. The fullness of Christ. We want all of him. All he has to offer. All the healing. All the prosperity. All the favor. That's what we're striving for. All of him. All of him and less of us. So he must increase and we must decrease. We must decrease. Paul says it like this. I die daily. We should be striving to kill something in our spirit, in our soul, in our flesh that's not like God. Daily. So that we will henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine, every fly-by-night doctrine that comes along. The church of the toe-out shoe, and you are anointed because you wear toe-out shoes, or the church of the 12-inch weave, and all these strange things that come along, all these strange doctrines. That's what children do. They go after everything that comes along. Well, we should mature to the point that we stick with things that are conducive to sound doctrine. Sound doctrine. If the word says it, God says it, Jesus says it, the Holy Spirit says it, I believe it, and that settles it. But everything that I do, everything that I try, everything that I test must pass the litmus test of the Word of God. Does it line up with what God says? Oh, Rebbe Si Kandalabashata. Holy Spirit is flowing tonight. Because it is in Him that the whole body is fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint is supplied. You know, every one of your joints, every one of my joints is significant. And this body is so fitly and nicely framed together by design of God that when one part of it hurts, every other part runs to its rescue. If you stump your toe, your hand automatically knows to grab and rub your toe. Your eyes look at your toe and look at it. It's the way the body is put together. Not all body parts are alike, but we all supply one to another. According to the effectual working in the measure of every part, making increase of the body into the edifying of itself in love. So, Pastor, what do you do if you believe that there is an apostolic anointing and flowing in your life? Well, there are certain practical steps that we should all take. Some years ago, I received a prophecy that I was to walk in the apostolic flow of God. Discounted it and disregarded it for years, probably, I don't know, 4 or 5 years. And finally, one day it hit that I'm not really walking in the direction that the Holy Spirit has unctioned me to do some time ago. So we decided to make a shift. That I want the same evidence. I want the same results as the apostles enjoyed in the first church. I want to lay hands on the sick and they recover. I want to lay hands on the bound and devils are cast out. I want to lay hands that chains are broken. I want to pray for the sick and they recover. Hallelujah. This is true if you're a member of the body that's walking in the apostolic flow, simply flowing in the anointing of the church in its original form and its calling and ministry. Hallelujah. Well, what do I do? Here's a few practical points I want to give you tonight. What do I do if I feel that I'm called to walk in the apostolic flow of God? Number one, you must study the Word of God. People that flow consistently in the apostolic flow of God consistently study the Word and don't just glaze and glance over it. They spend time meditating, meditating and reading and studying and absorbing the Word of God. They apply the Word of God to their lives and in their lives daily. Say daily. Word has to rule in our hearts and minds. It is the Word of God on the inside that equips us to serve in this great body of Christ. David said, "Thy word, Lord, have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you." My word, the Word of God, I've got to hide it on the inside. Not just giving the word lip service, but being an example of the word. We that walk in the apostolic flow believe that the scriptures are true and are trustworthy and that they are enough to have faith in that it is going to come to pass. We must have faith that the word of God spoken out of the mouth of God, and it is the ultimate authority in our life. For the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing into the dividing asunder, soul and spirit, joint and marrow. And the word of God is a discerner of the thoughts and intents, of the heart. Because when I regurgitate up out of my spirit through my mouth is an indicator of what's in my heart. Out of the abundance of the heart, the Bible says that the mouth speaks. I'm going to say what's in my heart. I'm going to speak what I believe in my heart. If I confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead, I shall be saved. Romans 10, 9 and 10. I'll be saved. It's as simple as that. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. A spirit. It's a spirit. That's why it's imperative that you and I have the Holy Ghost. We believe that all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable. Profitable for what, Pastor? Profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction, that the man of God, the woman of God may be perfect, mature, rightly dividing the word of truth. We believe that. We believe in the word of God. Being in the word at some point daily. I know you have to work, you have to go to school, you have to raise your family, but we should set an allotted amount of time aside to give God due reverence in reading, studying, meditating, memorizing, learning, and inwardly digesting and ingesting the word to apply it as doers of the word and not hearers only. The word of God. The word of God. So important. If you're going to flow in the apostolic spirit of God. Number two is as important as your prayer life. It seems to be a basic necessity, but it's so vitally important that we communicate with God daily, applying the name of Jesus, the blood of Jesus, and the power of the Holy Spirit to prayer, specifically in areas where we need things to change in our lives or the lives of those that we love. We must be point on, strategic, and specific in our prayer. Many Christians today, many believers today don't understand prayer. As it's set forth in the Bible, they do not practice biblical prayer. Biblical prayer is not begging God. Biblical prayer is not informing God of your issue. God already knows. God knows what we have need of before we ask. And before we can ever articulate and ask, God has already asked if we ask by faith, believing and not wavering. For the Bible says that a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Let not that man think that he shall obtain anything of the Lord. Too unstable. You're crazy. You're mental. What's wrong with you? Be specific in your prayer. Be intentional in what you pray. Be purposeful in your prayer. Must arise to an intimate relationship with God. Intimate to the point where we can hear his voice and obey his directions. We trust in the Lord with all our heart. We don't did that in our shatta. We do not lean to our own understanding in all of our ways, not some of our ways, not most of our ways, not the majority of our ways, but in all of our ways, we acknowledge him. And then he, in turn, directs our path. That's why the scripture declares that the steps of a good man or woman are ordered by the Lord, and the Lord delights in their way. That's true biblical apostolic prayer. Consistent in this response to pray. Not only does it empower us to be strong in the Lord, but also in the power of his might. Prayer leads and guides us into our rightful places in ministry. No, did God tell you that you're supposed to preach? Did God tell you that you're supposed to evangelize? Did God tell you that you're supposed to be a prophet or prophetess? Did God tell you that you're supposed to be a teacher? Did God tell you? Or you just had a feeling, in your flesh? That's why we need a heart to pray. Heart that receives heavenly unction, the Holy Ghost, confirms in the mouth of two or three witnesses. For in the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word is established. God always sends a confirming word when he gives us a word. That's why you don't need to go looking for a word. You got 66 books worth of word in the Holy Scriptures. 66 books of word. Lord, confirm the word that I believe that you've given me. If you've given me this word about what I'm supposed to do in the kingdom, then I want you to send a confirming witness. That should be our prayer. And I'm going to stop right here, but this last point, and we pray in the Spirit. The Bible says, and with an understanding. So we're always alert to what we should be praying for. I'm going to read one last scripture and then we're through. Ephesians 6 and 18. Praying always with all prayer and supplications. Not just praying willy-nilly or helter-skelter, but praying in the Spirit, supplication, watching thereunto with all perseverance, being able to persevere, being able to hold on in spite of circumstances that are surrounding us. Holy Spirit gives you persevering power. Feel the anointing of the Holy Ghost now. Persevering power. Power to persevere in spite of the negative influences and forces that are coming against your life. Praying with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Yeah, we have to pray for all saints. We have to pray for the saints we like, pray for the saints we don't like. We have to pray for the saints that like us and the saints that don't like us. We have to pray for the saints that agree with us and the ones that don't agree with us. We have to pray for the ones that's in your little clique and the ones that ain't in your clique. Shouldn't be any cliques in the kingdom, but unfortunately there are. Got some haves and have-nots, some likes and likes-nots. No, we should be praying for all saints because somebody prayed for me, had us on their mind. They took the time, the old saint said, pray for us. I'm so glad they prayed. I'm so glad. Aren't you glad they prayed? Aren't you happy somebody took time after working all day? Working all week to pray for us. They took the time. Oh, what a privilege it is to walk in the apostolic flow of God. To see the same evidence, the same results as the book of Acts had. Healed will be the sick. Restored will be marriages. Minds will be restored. Wayward children will come home. Marriages will be put back together. The divorce rate will go down. Sickness, disease, pestilence, and plague will be eradicated. Governments will begin to act right when we pray for our leaders. Yeah, we have to pray for our leaders. Whether we like them or not, the Bible says we should pray for them so that you and I will live a quiet and peaceful life. Pray for those who have rule over us so that we'll live a quiet and peaceful life. You may not like them, but they're nevertheless the leaders, and we have to pray for them. Amen, amen. So wonderful to have you here tonight. And tonight you may want to make Jesus your choice. You may want to choose him and make him the Lord of your life. He's already Savior. There's nothing we can really do about that. We had no opinion about that at all. He's already saved. Do you want to make him the Lord tonight? It's real simple. You may not be saved tonight. You may have never developed a personal relationship with Jesus. You can do that tonight. If you want prayer tonight, if you want to be saved, you want to send us your testimony, email us at walkinvictory@sbcglobal.net. Walkinvictory@sbcglobal.net. If you are accepting Jesus tonight as your personal Savior, or you're coming back to Him as a backslider, like the prodigal son did, or you're really not sure if you've ever been saved or not, you're not sure whether or not you did it right, or you don't have a church home, listen, Victoria's Word Christian Center is a wonderful place to fellowship. It's a wonderful place to belong. And it's real easy to do. You can register with us, and we'll send you a registration form. You can register. You can become a member of Victoria's Word virtually. And when we start back in the spring, live again by the grace of God, you can come and join this wonderful body of believers called Victoria's Word Christian Center, where we're developing disciplined disciples by the redemptive love of God. Listen, if you want us to send you a registration form, you can do that tonight. Just email us at walkinvictory@sbcglobal.net. Our website is Victoria's Word Christian Center. Victoria's Word Christian Center. Let's pray this prayer of salvation, this prayer of restoration, this prayer of deliverance, just for us. Father, in Jesus' name, pray with me. Father, say, Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for saving me. I believe that your word is true. Romans 10:9-10 says, if I confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead, your word says that I will be saved. Now, Father, I'm confessing with my mouth and I believe in my heart that God raised his son Jesus from the dead. And according to the scriptures, he's seated at the right hand of God the Father in heaven, making intercession just for me. I believe when he died on Calvary, he died just for me. He shed his redemptive blood just for me. And Father, tonight I'm saved. I'm reclaimed. I'm sure about my salvation tonight. And I intend, by the grace of God and the blood of Jesus, to become connected with a church that's teaching the unadulterated word of God, like Victoria's Word Christian Center. Father, I thank you tonight for allowing me to pray, allowing me to come home as the prodigal son did, in Jesus' name. Amen. Listen, God may have laid it on your heart. If you don't have a church home, we want you to consider sowing your tithes and offerings into Victoria's Word Christian Center. It's real simple. You can use the Cash App at $Victoria's Word. Cash App is $Victoria's Word. Or you can use the PushPay app at BWCC Give 77977. BWCC Give 77977. Listen, let me reiterate again. I want you to do those three things for me. I want you to subscribe to our channel so you will get every powerful, informative, life-changing message. Hit the subscribe button and subscribe. I want you to like it. Let us know that it's effective in your life. And I want you to share it with a friend, a loved one, a relative, a neighbor, a coworker. Will you do that for me? Listen, until next time, here on Victoria's Word Christian Center's YouTube channel, we walk by faith and not by sight.
Welcome to VWCC News Bulletin. Tony Evans, Crystal Evan Hoods, Presents Kingdom Women will be our feature book at Women Within Virtual on Zoom on October 10th, 2020 at 10 a.m. If you want to be a part of the Zoom meeting, contact us via email walkinvictory@sbcglobal.net and phone 248-385-2312. You will be glad and blessed to be there. God bless. Starting back next month, Isaiah 58 Outreach will be starting back up next month, every fourth Saturday in every month. We are accepting monetary donation, perishable items such as food, toiletry. You can cash up us your donation as required. Sow a seed to the poor, you will be blessed.